Tall.
Men were busy digging in, but it was hoped they wouldn't have more than an overnight stay. There was an urgency now to be on the move before the Antarctic winter got any worse. The guns of the Royal Artillery were dug in and camouflaged 3 miles up from Fitzroy at Bluff Cove, and the last of their ammunition was being flown in. The helicopters, the Sea Kings and Wessex are the workhorses of this fighting force. The war could not have been fought without them. The gun crews had already set their sights on Argentine troop positions 6 miles away on Mounts Tumbledown, Mounts William, Two Sisters, and Mount Sapper. Saturday the 12th. The men of the 2nd Parachute Battalion didn't have to wait long at Fitzroy, and they were delighted. They were being lifted 5 miles on and up to Wireless Ridge, overlooking the Argentines on Mounts Tumbledown and William, and we knew they were bent on getting to Stanley first.
We're all just waiting to go. So everybody's just wanting to get there and get over and done with.
Well, basically the same. Let's just get it over with and get home.
Sunday the 13th, first light, and the first casualties of the first night offensive were flown into the field hospital at Fitzroy. The wounds were almost entirely from artillery shrapnel. The Argentines were hiding behind a constant barrage from their guns set up inside Stanley itself. Guns that, according to reports, were firing from civilian areas, and which, if British guns had fired back, would have certainly guaranteed civilian casualties. So, for a while, British guns did not fire back, and our front line suffered. It was something the British soldiers would not forgive the Argentines for. British armour began moving to them along the track that is the high road to Stanley, the Scorpions and Scimitars of the Blues and Royals. 6 miles to town now, and three more mountains to go. We could just see Stanley in the distance, mostly hidden by Tumbledown and Sapper, and we could see smoke coming from buildings along the waterfront. We stayed with a Gurkha Signals company on Two Sisters as Argentine shells came in around us. Unfortunately, people have been seen on this skyline by the Argentine artillery spotters in Stanley. That's the reason they're shelling here, thinking that we are the main force. And behind us, shelling over our heads, are the British 105s. And all the time, helicopters coming in, dropping in troops. Here comes... That's another one of their guns. All the time, helicopters, Royal Naval and Royal Air Force helicopters are coming in, dropping troops off, even while this artillery is going on. Monday the 14th, after a night of constant artillery exchanges, with the fires in Stanley still burning and in 12 degrees of frost, British troops patrolled back to us. The Scots Guards, they said, had taken Tumbledown and the Gurkhas were advancing on Mount William. Then, just after 2 o'clock that Monday afternoon, the shelling stopped. At 4:05, Major Bill Dawson came out of his tent.
Gentlemen, I've just heard that the white flag is flying over Stanley.
They'd come off Wireless Ridge, quickly across the open valley, and up to the racecourse at the edge of town before anyone could stop them. The paras had made it. They were the first into Stanley, just as they said they would, just as everybody, possibly even the general's staff, knew they would. General Jeremy Moore, Commander Land Forces, was into Stanley soon after them to accept the surrender. And after 4 hours of what was loosely described as negotiations, the surrender document was signed by him and the Argentine garrison commander, General Mario Menendez. Just after midnight, British time, with the niceties of surrender settled, General Moore went to the hospital.
Hello.
Tuesday, 15th of June, men who had been here when the Argentines invaded on April the 2nd and had defended Government House returned there that first morning of peace and raised the flag over the building they'd tried so hard to defend. It is easy to criticise an enemy in defeat, easy to believe the half-truths that were rapidly beginning to circulate around Stanley. But it is true to say that the Argentines have not left the capital as they found it. Their filth and vandalism is everywhere. It looked as if they'd been under siege for 12 months instead of two. Proper hygiene must have been difficult in a garrison of 7,000 or more men, but it wasn't helped by turning the floor of the post office into a public lavatory, with 3 months' excreta to be hosed away by Stanley's fire brigade. And the narrow streets were used as much as rubbish dumps as thoroughfares, with rotting food and unwanted discarded equipment littering the gutters. The Argentines had an odd way of impressing the Falklanders to the Argentine way of life. The weapons of war are stacking high, and as one pile is gathered up and stored away, so another takes its place. A lot will be destroyed, but what is in good condition will become ours to use. Wednesday, the 16th of June. The prisoners seem to have accepted their defeat without any outward malice. Almost the reverse. They seem relieved to be out of it. Mostly young, mostly conscripts, mostly wondering why anyone, least of all them, should want to fight over such cold, wet Antarctic islands. The prisoners who suffered the worst humiliation were those waiting out on the airstrip. It had become their open prison. Thousands of them standing, sitting, wandering aimlessly about in the rain and biting winds.
This is a piece
Some lived in tents, mostly the NCOs. Others lived under any kind of makeshift shelter they can find, from oil drums, bits of damaged aircraft, some even in the cockpits of smashed aircraft, anywhere to keep dry. And surviving, like all defeated armies in the first days of defeat, as best they could. They moved only as fast as the British military could process them to the waiting ships. And the road that led from the airstrip to the harbour in Stanley was jammed with them. Long, shuffling lines of men. Cold, miserable, human litter of war. The paras remembered their dead in a Thanksgiving service at Stanley Cathedral.
The lad will not be going home with us. Those who we lost at Goose Green and Darwin, those whom we lost from Mount Longdon on to Radio Ridge.
Friday the 18th, at 11:30 that Friday morning, the three Falklanders who had died in the fighting, the only three, were buried in a tiny cemetery overlooking the harbour. Mrs. Sue Whitley, aged 30 and a teacher, Mrs. Doreen Bonner, 46, and Mrs. Mary Goodwin, 81. Their coffins were carried by 6 Marines and 6 paras. The women had died when British artillery bombarded Argentine guns that had been deliberately placed between their houses. Argentine prisoners in the streets, clearing up the rubbish, were told by their guards to take off their caps and stand to attention as the coffins passed. And then, unexpectedly, shortly after midday, a formation of Royal Naval Seeking helicopters flying a white ensign came overhead us.
Military success and an exercise in willpower that was not stopped by the casualties the Welsh Guards took at Bluff Cove. Michael Nicholson, who has reported all the days and all the miles of the task force, was with the assault.
For us, the battle for Port Stanley and the retaking of the Falklands began on Friday the 11th of June at Fitzroy, a very English-sounding name in very Scottish-looking countryside. Fitzroy was the headquarters of the 5th Infantry Brigade, the second arm of the British pincer movement that finally took the Argentine garrison. Men were busy digging in, but it was hoped they wouldn't have more than an overnight stay. There was an urgency now to be on the move before the Antarctic winter got any worse.
Have you seen them yet?
Cheers.
Get out.
The guns of the Royal Artillery were dug in and camouflaged 3 miles up from Fitzroy at Bluff Cove, and the last of their ammunition was being flown in. The helicopters, the Sea Kings and Wessex are the workhorses of this fighting force. The war could not have been fought without them. The gun crews had already set their sights on Argentine troop positions 6 miles away on Mounts Tumbledown, Mounts William, Two Sisters, and Mount Sapper, names we were to become very familiar with. At their headquarters, the officers of the 5th Brigade had assembled that Friday afternoon for their briefing, their final O group, before they in turn went out to brief their men. Brigadier Tony Wilson began.
First of all, I want to make absolutely certain that you're right up to date on our own deployment. There have been some minor changes, and we have moved some people around. And therefore, to get a common start point, you must know exactly where everyone is and what their orders are for the next 24 or 48 hours. Having then, as it were, set the scene, we'll look then at Commander Land Forces Falkland Islands' intentions, as far ahead as we can see them, and what his directive to the two brigades has been. I'll then tell you what 3 Commando Brigade are going to be doing, and how they intend to set about it, and then I'll turn your attention to this brigade, and tell you what 5 Brigade is going to do, and exactly how we're going to set about that. No doubt at all, we've got off to an extraordinarily good start here, despite some of the incidents that have happened since we arrived in this part of the world. We are in a very good position indeed. I intend to capitalize on it.
Saturday the 12th, the men of the 2nd Parachute Battalion didn't have to wait long at Fitzroy, and they were delighted.
Beautiful. Followed by jam and biscuits. And that Wayne smile.
They were being lifted 5 miles on and up to Wireless Ridge, overlooking the Argentines on Mounts Tumbledown and William. But they were to be held in reserve. They'd done their bit at Darwin and Goose Green, and they were to be held back. At least that was the theory of the general staff. But this was the Paris War, and we knew they were bent on getting to Stanley first. We knew because they told us so.
Fighting through. Just keep on going. There's no stop, no turning back. It's just straight through. No one been taught to turn back. Everything is just straight through. Just keep on fighting.
It's, in the eyes of most of the blokes here, it's something that has to be done, and it's principle, the fact that it land was ours to start with, and then they now try to take it from us, and nobody will stand for that, really.
So you haven't changed your mind at all?
No.
How about you?
No, I'm certainly not. Certainly not, no. I agree with everything he says.
I mean, when we left Blighty over two months ago, there was waving flags and everything else, lots of enthusiasm. And, you know, we felt the same way. Are you still feeling as strong about it, even though you've suffered?
Well, we've got to, haven't we? You know, we can't just jack halfway. You've got to carry on.
No doubts at all?
No, not at all.
And how about you?
Well, it's like he says, if you've got to do something, you've got to carry it out all the way through. No, he's jatting halfway through. We've got to take Stanley. It's no stopping us now, I don't reckon.
Well, it started off as British soil. Argies barged in, and we're here to kick them out.
And you're the people to do it?
Well, us and the rest of them.
Throughout that day, the airlift of men and supplies out of Fitzroy to our front line, the line of final confrontation, continued. There were to be no long route marches, no slow, cumbersome convoys of guns and vehicles. This was the war of the leapfrog, jumping from one attack to the next by courtesy of the Royal Navy's helicopters. Sunday the 13th, first light and the first casualties of the first night offensive were flown into the field hospital at Fitzroy. The wounds were almost entirely from artillery shrapnel. The Argentines were hiding behind a constant barrage from their guns set up inside Stanley itself. Guns that, according to reports, were firing from civilian areas and which, if British guns had fired back, would have certainly guaranteed civilian casualties. So, for a while, British guns did not fire back and our front line suffered. It was something the British soldiers would not forgive the Argentines for. Argentine casualties came too, medevaced in by British helicopter pilots who were risking their own lives under fire. An enemy who now shared the same hospital, an enemy given the same chance to live.
The first few hours of the battle for Stanley, and already we're getting little bits of information back from the people who are returning from the battlefield. We hear that the 3rd Marine Commandos and the 3rd Paras have taken their objectives after a seven-hour battle. They've taken Mount Longdon and they've taken Two Sisters. They have also taken many casualties. We hear that something like 90 prisoners, Argentine prisoners, are on their way back, being marched back through the snow across the mountains. Among them, we're told, is an artillery major carrying a map showing the positions of some of their major artillery batteries. We've also heard, though we can't be sure yet, because this is just hearsay coming back from the lines, that HMS Glamorgan, a destroyer, has been hit by a land-based missile while she was, this is during the night, while she was on bombardment, naval bombardment of Argentine positions on shore. But we hear that she's managing to steam safely out of the area back to the fleet.
Those prisoners began to arrive at Fitzroy. In that first hour, over 150 were flown in to be put into the sheep pens under guard. And they told the same story. The battle for Stanley was being fought on the mountains surrounding it. And we now had three of them, Mount's Two Sisters, Harriet and Longdon. British armour began moving to them along the track that is the high road to Stanley, the Scorpions and Scimitars of the Blues and Royals. Six miles to town now, and three more mountains to go. We could just see Stanley in the distance, mostly hidden by Tumbledown and Sapper, and we could see smoke coming from buildings along the waterfront. And we heard that the British commanders, unwilling to sustain further casualties from the Argentine guns hidden between the houses, had ordered them to be destroyed.
Just seen a bomb drop.
We were with the Gurkha Rifles, the men whose legend as hard fighters travels with them wherever they go. Their second in command was Major Bill Dawson, and on the top of Two Sisters, he briefed us.
We are trying to take advantage of that, the fact that the enemy have broken, and we're trying to double up in double quick time and take out Mount William and bring out some more troops around the side to cut off as many of the enemy as we can before going up into Stanley itself. The details of that are being worked out now. There's a certain amount of confusion as to who does what and how the resources are going to be made available to make certain that this operation can go on. But that is, at the moment, all I can tell you. That's all I know.
Now, This was not the front line. The front line was just ahead and below us. The attacks had all been planned to take place at night. There was too much open ground between the mountains, land without cover for British troops to risk daylight offensives. The night attacks were to be the key factor to our success. We stayed with the Gurkha Signals Company on Two Sisters as Argentine shells came in around us. We are on Two Sisters. We were helicoptered in with the Gurkhas this morning. Our job is to wait here with the tactical part of the 1st and the 7th Gurkhas and wait for the Scots to move ahead of us. They are now in the valley, moving up the side of the hill towards Tumbledown, and our job is to wait here and move in after them. Unfortunately, people have been seen on this skyline by the Argentine artillery spotters in Stanley. That's the reason they're shelling here, thinking that we are the main force. And behind us, shelling over our heads, are the British 105s. And all the time, helicopters coming in, dropping in troops. Here comes a... That's another one of their guns. All the time, helicopters, Royal Naval and Royal Air Force helicopters, are coming in, dropping troops off, even between, even while this artillery is going on. Monday the 14th, after a night of constant artillery exchanges, with the fires in Stanley still burning, and in 12 degrees of frost, British troops patrolled back to us. The Scots guards, they said, had taken Tumbledown, and the Gurkhas were advancing on Mount William. Royal Marine Lieutenant David Stewart told us of his part in the fighting.
And then last night, we came up as a company to take this position here. They'd removed themselves from where we initially had contact.
Was that machine gun?
That was a machine gun, yes. They weren't there. The first troop took that, and as we came up about 200 metres, we came under fire from up here and also further down as well. And then we simply came up as a company, two troop, came up here and took the SF positions, the machine gun positions, which were up here. We reckon there was about a company, but as we came up to them, they ran out, they bugged out.
What kind of weapons did they have? Is it just machine guns?
GPMGs, the same machine guns that we use.
Yeah.
And FNs.
You were under fire on the way up, were you?
Oh, yes. Yes.
Yeah. What kind of fight did they put up?
Initially, heavy fire. And then it appeared that as we put down our fire, and we were using the 66 anti-tank weapon, they began to move back from there. It appeared that they left sort of die-hard chaps up here. And as we got closer to them, they also ran away. So, in fact, we found no one up here at all. By the time we got here, they'd all gone.
Then, just after 2 o'clock that Monday afternoon, the shelling stopped. We could hear only the occasional small-arms fire, and that less and less frequently.
Hello.
The mountains and the valleys between them became silent. And then we thought of a possibility, a rather marvellous possibility. Was there a ceasefire? Could it be a surrender? At 5 minutes to 4, Major Bill Dawson came out of his tent.
All right, from there, Mike. Bill, right.
right. Gentlemen, I've just heard that the white flag is flying over Stanley.
8-2, a roger out.
Can you tell us what he said, Major?
What he has said is that negotiations will start tonight. Although there appears to be a ceasefire at the moment and the Argentinian forces in the Falklands have appeared to have surrendered, this does not necessarily mean that the forces in the mainland Argentine will necessarily stop fighting. Therefore, we will have normal CAP, that is air cover, combat air patrols, and we should take the normal precautions against being caught by surprise or whatever. Okay?
Yeah, is there a white flag flying?
There is a white flag flying over Stanley.
Very marvellous.
Well, that's how we heard the news at 5-4 on Monday, June the 14th, from an officer of the Gurkha Rifles, after what he'd heard over his radio from his own men overlooking Stanley. They're telling him that a white flag is flying over that town. Is this, then, the end to the war?
Taro Tahaja, sponsor. Hawkeye. Kura teste, sir. Nya onsa. Dui dui jana. Group groupma. Lirano patsa. Pat jamagana pori. Ani sabale. Wanko objective majansa bori rati kolagi.
Bloody marvellous, he said, and that summed it up for us perfectly. The paras had made it. They were the first into Stanley, just as they said they would, just as everybody, possibly even the general staff, knew they would. They'd come off Wireless Ridge, quickly across the open valley, and up to the race course at the edge of town before anyone could stop them. As long as people talk of the Falklands campaign, they'll talk of the Second Paras. Port Stanley, the only large village on the islands, had become a symbol for all the forces. So what happened after victory comes next.